Hi everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, A Picture is Worth a Thousand Words, A View of the Major Macro Markets. I'm Betty Smith, I'm Vice President of Communications here at CQG, and it's absolutely my pleasure to welcome Andrew Baptiste, CEO of TAG, the Technical Analysis Group. Hi Andrew.
Hello Betty.
All right, so Andrew's going to give us some insight into various markets using charting and analytics found in our flagship product, the CQG Integrated Client. But before we get rolling, as always, I'll cover some basic housekeeping. If you have any technical problems with the webinar, with the audio, please use the chat feature and our host will get right with you to resolve that. We'll take questions at the end of Andrew's presentation, but please submit your questions at any time during the presentation using the Q&A feature. In the webinar view, that's in the lower right-hand corner of your screen. In the full screen view, that's on the floating toolbar, as well as the chat for any audio or other technical problems. All right, so Andrew is the CEO of TAG, as I mentioned, which provides customers with real-time directional and tactical support. Previously, Andrew was Chief Technical Analyst at Morgan Stanley, as well as Senior Technical Analyst at JP Morgan. So with that very brief introduction, I'm going to pass this off to you, Andrew.
Thank you so much, and thanks to all of those in attendance. Let's get started right away. Very interesting juncture in the markets, to say the very least. Technically, we found it a challenging environment, but being cut off from the noise has been awfully helpful to me. When you consider, we call them the gagas, the global authorities, you combine this with a U.S. election coming up, and then get into the end of the Mayan calendar, and it makes for quite a little messy situation. But here's where we think, technically, where we stand. As you can see at the graph we're looking at 11 years of the S&P weekly bar chart. So you've seen, sorry about that. We're looking at 11 years. At 11 years of the S&P index, we think we're putting in the three-domed top. So what we'd like you to look at here is, here's our call. From 2000, which really is the high, and you look in terms of real money, and that's gold, we think that we've completed what's called an expanding flat. That allowed us in 2007 and 2008 to make a call that we would go under the 2002 low at 768.63, and that's at a bare minimum. So as you can see, we did trace out five waves off of the high in 2008 at 1576.09 down to a low of 2009 at 666.79. Would like to let you know, and one of the reasons we use the wave principle methodology, it actually makes up about half of our technical toolbox, so to speak. But what we really enjoy about this is if you take a look on the chart, and hopefully you can see the arrow, is just take a look at the way it starts. And as you may know, the wave principle business is a fractal. So there's wave 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Now, after five waves down, we should have a correction, typically between Fibonacci 38.2% and 61.8%, the golden ratio, but not above the 100% retracement mark. So that gave us the setup. We did retrace about 50%. Thereafter, you can see we can continue down in five waves to complete wave 3 at about 780, a rebound in three waves to about 955, and then a final plunge down. I do want to tell you at this time that the daily sentiment index, which I'll refer to several times during this presentation, was at 2%. It's the lowest ever seen, and this data goes back through 1987. And again, we will refer to it quite a bit. Since then, as you can see, a most difficult pattern. But bottom line, last year we called for a move down to a value zone, and we did reach it, and here we go again, climbing higher, nowhere near what we thought was value for 2012. Now, this is where it gets all very difficult. In March of this year, TAG set up a short at 1406. The goal was 1300 plus minus 10, but this is where it's most interesting from a wave principal perspective. At that time, in late May and again in early June, the idea was that if we did not go under 1266.73 cash S&P, then we would not have wave overlap, and then theory has it that we would take out the high of early April at 1422.38. Well, amazingly, the low on June 4th was 1266.74. So 0.01, no overlap. So that was our call. It looked very, very improbable at the time. I can tell you that looking at the pattern on the way up, if you look at the period between basically you're talking April through most of June, a most difficult sawtooth pattern, and all we could tell you at the time there was that we felt there was a mysterious force below the market. And what I mean by that is there's a pitch that you can see on the shorter term charts that seemed that every time we would have a sell-off, it was met with a spike. It looked like they were late day buyers, not to get into conspiracy theories or about the plunge protection team, which we all probably think is out there. But bottom line, getting to the story now, TAG has set up a 1/5 short in the S&P, added to it last Thursday post-Fed at 1447. So we're averaged about 2/5 short at approximately 1425. Orders up top at 1485 is the next fifth we intend to put into play. I do want to mention at this time, we are looking for the three domed top. Again, it's very scary as we go into this very frightening period that we think will be associated with great volatility. But getting back to the daily sentiment index, I just want to point out that on June 1, the daily sentiment index was 5% bulls, and then it was 9% on June 4th. June 4th also was that low of 1266.74. As you can see on the graph that you're looking at now, we have gone above what we call a speed line. There's certainly no signs of exhaustion and reversal. We only can tell you that at this time, tomorrow, if you see the cash below 1455, 1458, we think there's going to be a sell-off to test the level of which the Fed took off from, and that's basically 1440 down to 1435. That latter level, 1435, would also represent the 50% mark of this month's rise, approximately 1394.50 to 1474.75. Well, actually, exactly. Right now, we're trading in a 10-point range, nothing to do. There are no signs of impulse. But again, for now, just look at 1455 to 65. We are looking for signs of exhaustion. We do not think there's going to be a for sale sign at the top. Thus, we're backing in to this position using fifths to enter into the position. Take a look also at the bottom of the chart, and you'll notice stochastics or divergence. That would be here. You can see that we still have percent K and percent D, which you have K above D, so momentum still is to the upside, and until we see a shift, which usually, of course, follows a downside price action, we're in no rush to add to this position at this time. Will we add on to weakness? Yes. If we see a 5-wave down and 3-wave retracement back up, we're more than happy to join in at lower levels. But as it stands, we're running with the program, as uncomfortable as it may be.
Andrew, it's Betty. I just want to let you know that if you're using a pointer tool, I'm not seeing it.
You're not?
No. So
okay,
it might
let's
be
try
helpful.
Something else.
All right,
how
thank
about
you.
Okay, thanks, Betty. Can you see it now, anybody? No. Okay, moving on to chart two. Here's a very simple one. We were looking for markets. If you look at the S&P from 08-09 and look at the SH comp, they're diabolically in opposite directions. So we're trying to pick up something cheap. We recognized 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, that we had an alarm set as we got down to the lower pitch that you can see in green, circled by the orange ellipse. From that time, we have an outside week. Now, in the conventional charting world, we would view that outside week, which bottom line means we've had a low for a move, then we closed above the previous week's high. In this case, it's actually a key reversal in that it's been from a multi-year low. So, bottom line, while 2029, the low, contains weakness, we're looking for a move up in the SH comp. So we've been running a position since Thursday of last week, from 2040, and our stop is at 2028. We saw an immediate instant gratification with a rise of 5.7%, Since then, of course, that has not played out well. It's backed up, but just keep that in mind. As long as 2029 contains weakness, look for movement above 2160 to usher in the third wave that we think could bring us up to around 2400 to 2500. So that's the SH comp. There is no great story there, but if you look at the drifting price action off of the mid-2009 high, it's all overlapping. They're all in waves of threes. We think it's part of a holding pattern. If you asked me what's the weak side, 1664 or 3482, I'd have to say 3482 is the weaker side. So we're willing to take a low-risk shot at owning the SH comp. There's several ETFs that one can try and play that through. This is spot gold we're looking at. It's obvious on everyone's mind. Interesting how it wasn't just 2 months ago when we were loitering in the mid-1500s. But here's our story. We saw a move up to 1921.50 before a drop of $389 to a low of, I believe, 1532.20. That $389 decline sported impulsive qualities, which you would not be able to see on a monthly bar chart. Since that time, we've traced out what we think is a wave B triangle. So it means it's part of a connecting, longer-term, more complex correction. The bottom line here is this. We've been playing the upside for the past 3 months, trying to buy anywhere in the mid to low 1500s, recognizing that a break of 1522 to 1532 would represent not only a stop loss for a new long position, but we felt at that time that if 1522 to 32 gave way, we could have a swift move down to approximately 1390, if not 1270. That's not how it played out, and that's the way that our preferred wave count suggested that we would have a move up, and we've been looking for a move to $15 either side of 1800, so 1785 to 1815. So far, we've exited most of the long gold position. We did not get filled on our order at 1780 today. We have orders at 70 done, 80 open, 90 figure, and 10, and those last two are to get short. Now, it's going to be very uncomfortable. We all know that you have to have gold. It's on the side of buses. You can buy it in airports around Europe. Just remember, when it's Armageddon, you can't eat it. So 1,800 plus minus 15 is where we're going to take a shot at actually getting short in gold. Our stop loss is quite large. It's at 1,921.51, meaning any break to a new high, we must exit the position. But our feeling is that at 1,800 plus minus 15, you are likely to see a reversal. As it stands right now, we can only say that there's support in and around the $1,700 level until we get back under approximately 1735 plus minus 10 bucks, so 1725 to 45. We think the most likely course for spot gold is another down-up sequence. So a pullback and then a rise up, we hope, towards $1,800 plus minus 15. Again, we're setting shorts at that level. Stop loss is at 1921.50. The bare minimum would call for a move under the one-year range base at 1522 to 32. Below there, we're looking at 1395-ish and then 1270. From there, assuming we finish off a zigzag, which is what this count appears to be so far, put it this way, this is the most important factor. When you think about 1921.50 down to 1532.20, a $389 decline, the key there is that it's impulsive and leading. Right now, we're not overly concerned whether that $389 decline is wave one in a new bear market or wave A of an A, B, and C corrective zigzag. Either way, what we're trying to capture is a move of $400 to $600 down from the 800 level. I'm pretty sure you probably haven't heard that story today. One of the timing things we're using is gold in euro. We see no reason to rush to getting short euro, at least until the gold in euro finishes off its sequence. And for you waivers out there or conventional chartists, just note that we've traced out over the past year a contracting triangle. Here's where it's interesting. Contracting triangles are typically or often seen in the last leg before a sequence ends, in wave four positions, wave Bs also. In this case, it's a wave four. So after a year of winding, we're calling for a move to the upside that takes us above the high, which is 1359.1. Now, just keep in mind that getting down to the minutia or smaller details is very, very difficult. The reason being is we're using a line chart. That's what's available to us, so we're not seeing the highs and lows. But as it stands, we've matched the high in euro and gold, but post-triangle thrust suggests it should trade not only above 13.5910 bare minimum, but we have a measuring objective based upon the width of the triangle and then added on to what we think is the last leg of the contracting triangle at approximately 12.56, and we come up with around 14.25. We're going to use that as a cue to exit gold, and hopefully at that time it will sync up with our 1800 plus minus 15 level for spot gold. So keep that one in mind. As it stands right now, backing up below the red line, the top or former boundary of the contracting triangle, which currently intercepts at 13.18, and as you can see, the nice, tidy, tested green trend line rising up, the smaller one, by the way, then we would abandon that idea and reassess at that time. As it stands, we think we're in the last throes of post-triangle thrust. We can see another 2% or so, 13.15 up, around 14 and a quarter, but thereafter, we are looking for this to reverse course. Just do keep in mind, triangles often precede the last leg in a sequence. The next chart up is pretty important. This is the dollar index. We're looking at 40 years. This is very important to understand that the Dixie is 57.6% euro. So you may as well turn this upside down, and you're basically going to get a shot of the euro. As you can see, the next largest components are the yen, which we daringly call the House of Pain because it basically tortures everyone who dares go in there. 13.6%, so it takes quite a bit of movement from the other five components in order to shake the Dixie. The euro really is the tail of the dog, is the dog. The rest are the tail. We've been calling now since 2008 early for a move up. We note that the first move of 25%, again, we view as a leading sequence, meaning that then take a look at the move down from the red line, and you can see that last year down to the blue, it's in three basic waves. We believe that's corrective in nature. So last year we put out a story that long-term support should start at 73.25. And while that wasn't the precise low, I think you can see by using a very fat trend line, I captured 6 months of lows. If you take the 6 months of April through September, the average was 73.33. So pretty close to what we call a wave of quality-based measurement. Now, that's all fine and dandy, and as you can see, then the monthly stochastics swung to the upside, allowing us to continue to play the upside. And it worked rather well for a period of time. But what we noticed on the way up, and then we're going to get to that on the next slide, is that the Dixie advanced in fives, set back in threes, and it had done this now 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times. There were 7 waves up, and yet there was no breakout to the upside. Now, when you go to the next graph, you'll see, we're going to look at a little more detail here. So now you're looking at 10 years. There's the five-wave advance, 2008 up into 2009. 3 waves down in what we see as a zigzag, W, X, and Y. Now you can see the part I'm speaking about. Off of last year's exact low of 72.69, wave 1, wave 2. And then as you can see, the entire move up is full of overlap. Well, that's not the way it's supposed to work in a third wave. There should be an impulsive section that isn't retraced. It's something that a lot of traders look for, and especially people, if you know about the turtles are especially inclined to look for these cups and saucers. And then you have a high volume move that is never retraced. Those are the types of moves that the turtles were trained to capture, taking quick losses and letting those winners run. That never happened here. In fact, we noticed that the last move up from late spring to July 23rd. Look at the last leg between 6 and 7. 1, 2, and in other words, A, B, C, and 2, 3, 4, and a fifth. So at 84.05 on July 23rd, we mentioned that there's a large caution. There's a warning here. The reason I mentioned the warning then is that I have a theory, and it's not a rule. It's a guideline, and there's thousands of them, whereas there's only 3 actual rules of the wave principle. I think that's why I chose it. But just take a look at that. So after that, if there was going to be an explosion, there should have been a very limited pullback to perhaps the green trend line, and then we should have taken off. And when I mean take off, I mean 6 figures in a month. It should have ripped. But this is where it became troubling, and I noticed that what else is that 7 waves up? Well, ABC, X, ABC. So 1, 2, 3, ABC, then the X, and then 5, 6, 7 is the next ABC, a W, X, Y. It's corrective in nature. I'm not sure how this fits. So I'm thinking to myself that what we have here is that the 2008-2009 advance still is an impulse wave, and we will go above that level. So while I'm sure there are dollar bulls out there who are hurting, and this is all very painful, I would like to suggest to you that I think that the 73-74 level is very, very strong support. I do not see us going below it. In fact, if I had to guess, I think that we've already completed wave A, and we are going to have a large-sized rebound, and then we might dig deeper again towards maybe the 618 or 786 retracement levels, but I do not see us going below the 2010 and 2011 low. So I think that's important to keep in mind. Also, if you take a look in terms of the DSI, once again, that's been the one that has been the most pronounced. I'm going into a program I have in front of me, trying to find the Dixie. No? So if you look at the Dixie, just recently, we've gone the five-day average. And isn't it interesting? It comes down near the 50% mark, and you can see a green box where I've suggested that this would be the two-week range base. And so far, of course, it's holding in there. We've had a slight pullback in the euro today. Well, it's nearly 2 points off of the euro high. But at any rate, it's interesting to note that over the past 5 days, we've seen readings of 9% bulls, 7% bull, 9% bulls. And as of yesterday's close, which was SEP 18, we have 10% bulls and a five-day average. These are not the lowest readings I've ever seen, but I just believe that we're pretty much burnt on the downside. And I highly recommend to avoid selling the dollar into weakness in a broad manner at this time. I may have interest towards the orange ellipse and the backside of the green trend line around 81.40 to 81.85. That would also represent about 6.18% of the recent decline. Unfortunately, I can't give you yesterday's low at 78.60 as a stop loss. I only can advise at this time to avoid selling dollars into weakness. I think it's baked in the cake at this time. Again, I would point out a five-day reading of 5% bulls. This is the euro. First, I wanted to show you the long-term chart. Who knew the euro was in an uptrend? Not me. I look at this and go, okay, broadly speaking, when we use the Deutschmark prior to the 99 inception, you can see that broadly speaking, we have an uptrend for the euro. After hitting an all-time high of 160.40, we've been looking for a move down to the lower side of this large, big-picture trend. You may note, looking at the intercept on the right side of your superb CQG machine there, 104.50, we still think that's possible. But here's what we think happened recently. We've been playing the downside, and up until July 23rd, we put out, again, the warning on the Dixie. And as I mentioned, 57.6% of the Dixie is the euro. So with that said, when we put out a warning and a caution and now advise on the Dixie, the same we put out for the euro, suggesting there would be a rise up towards 125.80 to 127.50, but if the strength carried above 1.3003, it would create wave overlap. Well, as you all know, we have done that now on above 130.03. We believe right now we are going to continue higher, not directly. We do think that we're going to head up towards 140.50 plus minus 2.5 euros. That's 138 to 143. So that's where we think we're headed. But we believe that due to the fact that we're in a contracting range, that all the legs within it should be legs of threes, corrective in nature. That's common, in fact, as a requirement within corrective legs, whether zigzags, doubles, triples, expanding, contracting triangles, they should be in legs of threes. So keep that in mind. We think that the 11.5 figure run-up in the euro is rich. We would suggest that if you get a setback that looks like hell in a handbasket, 127.50, all the way down to 124.40, we regard that as the one-month range base for the euro. So keeping in mind the Dixie at 10% bulls, the euro not quite as high. There's still a lot of euro haters out there. My feeling is if we sell off in the euro, by the way, it is likely to be met with some of those euro bears who are stuck below the market. So keep this in mind. We do think that there's scope up to 140.50 plus minus 2.5 euro. Just note that it could be quite a time-consuming and messy affair. Just note that the stochastics at the bottom of the page have swung higher with rising percent K above rising percent D, so we do have positive momentum on a monthly basis now. But keeping in mind, three-legged affairs. Just look at the last move down from 149.44 to 120.42. Full of overlap the entire way down, a very messy structure, as was the move from B to C, as was the move from A to B. All three-wave leggy affairs when you scope out at this time frame. This is euro on a short term. So there was the five waves down. When we put out the warning, it was trading near 120.50. We played the long side three times, and then it's better to be truthful. But since 126, 127, we have not caught this move up. We thought it might fail there. It did not. The Fed got involved, and our rule base suggests when you don't know, get out of the way. There's a train pulling out of the station every 15 minutes in this business. We do have 50,000 instruments to choose from. So as it stands, we want to buy in the box green. We want to sell at the box in red. In between right here, we don't think it's a smart move to play. When we see five waves down and a three-wave retreat, we might be able to set up a tactical short. But the primary goal now is to try and take advantage of weakness to pick up euros at a cheaper level and try and get the next 10 to 14 figures to the upside. This chart is the last chart, I think. No, sorry. This is the pound, aka cable. For those of you who don't know, it used to be traded via wire under the transatlantic. That's why it's called cable. Also, this chart would show you that for 37 years we've been between 250 and 1. Interesting to note, it was 11 to 1 110 years ago. I guess that's why they called it Great Britain. Anyway, looking at this chart, you can see that after a sharp decline, 211.60 to 135.04, we believe that was an impulse wave. So here's the most interesting features of this chart. If you go back to 1985, when we were near 104, I've been in business 31 years. I do recall this quite clearly, that at the time, there were a lot of bets out there for a breaking of 100. Of course, painfully, 24 years later, it rises up to 211.60. But here's the key. Look at 1985, then look at the 2008. Notice, a broad stroke, use a wide brush, but it's three basic waves, i.e., that movement is corrective in nature. So with a gun to my head, I think 135 and 104 are the weak side for the pound. Now, let's get to something useful. For 3 years now, we've sat in a contracting range. And as you can see, the monthly Bollinger Bands are beginning to contract, which if you look back across the chart, once they've contracted and start to pull apart, this usually is a sign of a more radical, violent move with greater volatility, and we think it's going to be quite directional. Now, two ways to count it. If you look at this chart, the one thing I can tell you is right now we're less than 0.5% away from one actionable level, and that's 163.02. That's the high of this year from April. If it breaks that level, the immediate contracting bearish triangle is negated, and that opens up the top side. If you break 167.48, we'd be inclined to think that we're headed up as high as 182 in the pound. That's if it breaks 163.02. We're thinking right now to take a look at volatility and try and play it through straight vol, or if you are very bearish the pound, then 163.03 would be a very tight stop loss. And imagine this. If one was to take advantage of what is now about 80 pips or 0.5%, look at the levels you have to add to it. One, you could use the trend line in gray on the bottom to add to a winner. So you'd be about 8 to 9 points in the money at that point, assuming 163.03 doesn't give way. Then, if you take a look at the last 8 quarters, you have a cluster of lows all in and around 162.50. I think the actual low is 162.33. Thus, you could stop in on another third or add another third or tripling down under 162.50. You're now, again, adding to a winner. If that's the case, we would then use a parabolic type stop loss. Typically, our parabolic stop losses are not mechanical. They're based upon internal wave structure. Again, as I've mentioned in the Dixie, I think the writing's on the wall that the dollar is not going to explode anytime soon. I think it is going to buy time. The pound does look very interesting. It is off everybody's radar screen. Everything's going well. great Olympics. They won a ton of medals. It's all beautiful there. But let's not forget, there's problems also in GB land. So just will tell you, it can be greatly delayed if you go through 16302 and then confirmed above 1.6748. That gives you upside. And again, I'm looking for something in the low 180s, if that's the case. Until then, here's the way we play it in Tagland. If the recent high, we see a five-wave decline down on a 15-minute chart, that's followed by three waves up, we're very inclined to take advantage of that because of what? Low-risk opportunity. Under 157.50, our antennae would definitely begin to twitch, because we would think then that there's a chance that maybe the bearish pattern, while it's been pushed to the very limits, we think that it's good for a go. So right now, we are a bit hesitant post-Fed because they have changed things a bit out there. So we're going to let the price action to speak for itself. So if you say, let the market speak, and that's exactly what we intend to do. We see no signs of exhaustion or reversal at this time in the pound. But again, look at the formation. We're heading towards the apex. Bollinger Bands have contracted. And even the RSI, you take a look, comp RSI, that's in a triangle. So we're going to use all of the above in order to signal a move that we think will be worth 15 to as much as 20 points in either direction. So we're hoping the pound provides us a great trade idea coming up. This chart I find fascinating. Here we are all worrying about the Gagas providing unlimited QE, which of course we know is inflationary, of course. And you just look at this chart and begin to, it gives you a lot of thoughts. I've been tracking this particular chart for many, many, many years now, and it's been quite useful the last four times since 98. I've been using this channel base. We call it the mother of all channel bases. And indeed, you can see here, it has recently, Q2, it captured that low and offered about 30 points. And more recently, we've seen a move down exactly to the top of the mother of all channel bases, which through the end of September, Q3 is at 137. The low is 1.379. We've had a move up of 52 basis points to 1.899. But here's the problem with that. A couple of things, actually. The price action up the low, 52 basis points, as you can see, really doesn't even show up on the chart much yet. It's highly doubtful we're going to have a key all-time reversal with a move above 225 by the end of September. Stranger things have happened. But more importantly, when I look at the internal wave structure that you cannot see at this detail, I think it's very important to know that from where we stand, the legs to the upside are not impulse legs. And while we all want to be bearish bonds, I think we all can admit that. We all want to be short. I just will remind you that there are no signs of exhaustion reversal. And frankly, when I look at the internal price action, it still looks corrective in nature. And here's the real deal. When you look at the last chart of the presentation, off of the high, just below 4, just note 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 3. That would mean that we should have an ABC, and then it's falling to new lows. Very difficult. Now, good news about technicals. One, you had 1.37 as a great place that has served us so very well for many, many years, as you can see here. Two, you have an outside week against that low. So we started pitching the upside, suggesting we would trade up towards a couple of levels. 2 to 206 in terms of yield, that should get us to what we consider to be 3.82% of the last completed five waves, and it's where a wave of quality, meaning that if you look off the low, 137 up to 186, then a pullback to 154, if you take the length of waves A and C, assuming a zigzag, it suggests that we could reach up again to 2 to 206. It's from that level that I would be expecting downside. If that comes earlier, you can see that we've already met the bare minimum for wave C, which means it has to eclipse the top of A, which it has by about 3.7 basis points. So the bottom line is this. We think that this price action off of the mother of all channel bases is interesting, but I just want to point this out to you. Never be in a rush, because I've seen many people carried out of this business trying to play the never-to-be-seen JGB bubble for 14 long years. In fact, there's a period in 10-year yields in Japan where for 6 years we were in an 85 basis point range. As I said, it's like training for a marathon inside your closet to be avoided. That's the end of the chart portion. thanks for coming on in today. Really appreciate you being here. If there's questions to be had, Beth, take her away.
All right, absolutely, Andrew. We do have a few questions, and I will invite everyone else to submit your questions at this time using the Q&A feature of the webinar. So, Drew, when you were looking at slide 7, which was spot gold in the euro, the daily line chart, it's a question from Craig. I'll give you a minute to get there.
Yep.
Slide 7, great. Given the trend is so bullish, why wouldn't you wait to initiate a short position below 1,500 in USD terms?
We're in a predictive business. One thing I like to do, and the reason I'm still doing it, despite my advanced age, that was a joke, buddy.
Sorry, I should have laughed.
I know. No, the reason is we're in a predictive business. I would have a hard time waiting $400 and selling into a hole when we have global authorities and others in a very strange time. I bent on being predictive. That's been our call. The fact that it has responded to a move that, this is why. If you look at 1530 to 1560, we bought there 2-3 times, pulled out $50, $70. Then when it went through 1641, the idea was we would trade up. Because we've made money being long when everyone else really, I mean, think about it. Until not even 6 weeks ago, or certainly 2 months ago, most people were thinking that gold looked tired, that it hadn't made any ground, and now everyone's bullish again. I'm, you know, for me, I'm not going to wait $400, $300-odd to get short. We are going to take our shot up there because we do believe, again, that the $389 decline, 1921.50 to 1532.20, is impulsive in nature. Now, it's important for you all to know that we use timeframes from nano to micro to near to medium to long to big picture. We set expectations on all timeframes. When they track well, meaning that they conform to expectations, we think we're tracking the right pattern. So when we see that that $389 decline in five waves should have yielded a pullback, well, it certainly has. It's almost been 1 year. So we believe we're tracking the right pattern. Now, there's another way to play this. Allow this to go up to 1,800 plus minus 15. Then if we see an hourly five waves down, we would have a couple of things to tell you. One, where the ensuing hourly rebound should carry to. Two, we can't retrace more than 100%, so we have a set stop loss. Then someone who is less risk or more risk averse could sell into that with very limited risk and then add below 1,500.
All right, Drew, excellent, I know. It's kind of an exciting webinar today. I feel like a little bit like I'm on the game show and you haven't used the bell. All right. And now everyone hates me. All right, so the next question refers to slide 11, Euro-USD daily bar chart.
Yep.
And it is from Steve. So you think the euro can rally and gold break?
Yes, the timing is not going to sync up. Most things, that's not the way it's worked. TAG does major macro markets, the reason being we know how correlated the markets are. We will not even pretend to tell you about the timing of this. It could, I don't know how that's going to play out. It would seem unlikely, but in the current environment, I wouldn't put it past it. No, I think it's possible.
All right, and then a follow-up from Steve. With all the global easing, have you adjusted your approach to using technicals?
Not really. If there's one thing that I've learned to do is to get off of a trading floor and work out in a 223-year-old barn, because I feel the less noise, the greater ability do you have to get through the noise and the biases that that noise provides. What I have found to be true over the past 3 to 4 years of Gaga Land, again, global authorities intervention, is we've changed our time frames. Trading for the long term, we don't think that's the way to play anymore. Our orientation has become much more micro to near term, 24 hours to 1 week. I mean, consider this. We consider medium term now to be up to 1 month. That's only as of the last 4 to 5 years. Typically, I would call that 3 months. We consider something more than a year to be big picture at this stage. That's how frightening we think the environment is. And to get right to it, technicals are not everything. What they do provide is framework and discipline. Here's the very quick story. 10 trades, 7 of them are wrong for 1%. three winners of 3, 5, and 8%. If you do the mathematics, it means that you net 9% over the 10 trades. But the ego doesn't like that. The ego thinks that you're a loser. Me, I have no problem with that. Call me loser with 9%. We're very intent on taking quick losses. Even if you have a bias in the market, I'd rather go short three times with a 1% stop loss than to get carried out. And I think this is just the type of environment where this is going to happen.
All right. We have a couple more questions, and then we'll probably wrap up. Back to gold. So a question from Tony. For gold, if it doesn't turn out to be a wave X as labeled, what wave would you put?
Well, the only other count I can come up with is this, and it's what we call an alternate count, meaning there's validity to it. It's not my favorite, and it hasn't tracked that well. I would call this post-triangle thrust, meaning that the move down is 1921, not to 1532, but to 1522. There's A, back up to 1800, B, C, D, and E. So we completed a contracting triangle. The reason I don't use that is two reasons. Notice the price action above 1800 leaves what we call railroad tracks. Railroad in, railroad out. It's rejection. My grandmama's mama has gold at that level. That's why it's so strongly rejected. Now, the second reason, we count 1921.50 to the first low at 1532.20 as five waves. And the fact that it responded from that makes us think that we're on the right track. I will tell you that if we do get up to our $15 either side, or let's call it a percent either side of 18, we wouldn't expect it to stay there long. We wouldn't expect it to loiter above. As you can see, again, those railroad tracks are telling me that there's rejection up there. And while we all love it now and we know that it's the greatest thing in the world to have, I just, you know, like for me, where are you at 1550 and 1570? You know, that's where I'm at. Again, we're trying to be predictive, and while we can get whacked, in fact, on the gold, we're going to have to take a small position because the risk level, again, would be 1815 and 1921.50, so it's near a 6% loss, so we're going to have to scale properly. We will not be able to back up the truck there. So one, we'll put one unit out and then wait for a smaller degree five waves down in order to add to that position because then we have a lower stop loss. That's our approach.
All right. And Andrew, our last question's from Leslie. Any thoughts on the dollar yen other than the pain?
Hi, Leslie. Hey, dollar yen, let's face it. We had a great call in dollar yen years ago. The idea there was, and I wish we had it here because it is a fun chart, and Leslie knows this to be true, so speak up if you need to, Leslie. You spent 13 years in a contracting range. That's why we started calling it the House of Pain, because in contracting ranges, the basal ganglia, that part of your brain that is herding instincts, that's where typically at towards the top end of a range, you come up with reasons why you like it. And at the bottom of the range, you come up with reasons to dislike it. It's really being led around by the nose, or as we call some people in the market, we call them wind socks, meaning wherever the wind goes, they go. Well, I'll be honest with you. Our call in dollar yen at 124 was that we would make a new all-time low below 79.75, and this was in the summer of 2007. Why? Well, it completed a contracting triangle. Did anyone care? No. At the time, there was big stories about Mrs. Watanabe had finally figured out that the yen didn't yield anything, so she had to get rid of yen, i.e. sell yen, buy dollars, and buy things you really like Aussie and New Zealand, which proceeded to collapse 50%. It's interesting to me because the risk at the time, I mentioned that the legitimate risk was a 10-figure stop loss. It had to go above 135.40, so of course the idea was poo-pooed. But it is interesting that we have dropped over 45 yen. We have satisfied the long-term call. And this chart, if you're obviously your CQG people, put up a quarterly chart of dollar yen and put up a stochastic. And note that, did you know, quarterly stochastics, big picture, are actually running positive. So we've been suggesting, we've been trying to be buyers down here. We actually had a great run of which we caught 7 yen and then promptly gave back 5 of it. So it's a very difficult, the reason we call it the House of Pain, and for you who enjoy markets out there, just so you know, Leslie does, Euro-Yen we call the Eye Gouger, we call JGBs the Crypt. Just think about it. House of Pain, Eye Gouger, the Crypt. Trading in Japan is an exercise in futility, but I do believe there's a huge move coming at some point. We cannot even secure the 75.54 all-time low at this time. But we did mention recently that we should go under 77.65, which we did. And interestingly, we call 77 the figure, plus minus 50 pips, as a no-fly zone. And what that means is just that. Don't touch that. And if you just noticed, we had a monster rise from that level after crushing people, taking all stop losses out of the market. It does exactly what we're used to in the House of Pain. It goes up two figures. It's really incredible. Near 3% rise after stopping out most dollar yen longs. We're looking for reasons to like it. We'll play it straight against the dollar. Recently, we've been long dollar euro yen. We've exited that position. At this time, we're looking to rebuild the new long. We do believe the recent rise from 77.13 to 79.23 is a five-wave affair. We're trying to rebuild the position 15 to 20 pips either side of 78, the figure, so that's 78.18 down to 77.91 specifically, and our stop loss would be below 77.13. Confidence level? Well, it's the House of Pain. So we do want an identifiable three-wave decline before we get back involved. Sentiment is not an issue there. Most people are brain dead. So I don't really know if they really participate in sentiment surveys.
All right, Andrew, thank you once again for the dynamic, fast-paced, excellent presentation today. It was wonderful. Absolutely necessary. I just want to let everybody know that this webinar has been recorded and it will be available in a few days. I want to thank all of you so much for joining us today and let you know that our next webinar will be Bell Curve Trading Supply and Demand Trading Methodology on October 10th. So, Andrew, thank you once again. Have a great evening.
Thank you all. Thanks for coming in today and be careful out there.